So if I make a lot of stupid comments and my brain doesn't work properly, I apologise in advance.
Yes, and we are recording.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Right now, the unedited version of the book is available on Amazon as well, but I will not show it because we want to focus on this version, this rewrite.
Do you want to explain a little bit of what you've done as well?
Yes, so what I have done here is take a bunch of notes that we took last time, and also take the original text, and I have cut them up into sections. And basically, what I have here is the outline that is the result of our, I think, last time discussion or the one before that. Anyway, the outline that we have developed based on the existing material. That makes the number titles here, and under each title there is a slice of notes that we have taken about this particular scene or this particular point, and underneath that the long walls of text are the original material which will work as a reference, but we will not try to contort the original text into anything new. We will just sort of bounce off of it. And today's agenda, or today's master plan, dare I say, is to work through maybe one or two of these outline points. And under each point, work out a low commitment text version, like the level of professionalism that we put into the forum and website reading samples. So my plan is that if we work based on the let's not worry too much, then the text will flow easier. We will get our material down, and then there will be a further vision at some point. So, in a way, I would say that the forum / website reading samples will make for rather good second drafts on some material. Shall we?
Yeah. Nicely explained. So this first one, I think our thoughts were to just try and make this a single paragraph instead of what I did with the original text. And I do like this dirty rain sloshed upon the dimmed rent a skimmer's exterior as it sped through the warehouse district. Vehicle came to a stop at X and spat out two passengers and buzzed away. I like that. I think this is a good start, solid start.
Yes, I don't like the statement monolithic here. Like, it's not about the word, it's about making the claim that the warehouse district was monolithic. Whereas what we've discussed now and what we've established now about that is anything but.
So we should cut that, definitely.
Just leave it now. Right. I will work it out.
Okay.
Expressing the general sentiment that this is not about the word choice here, this is like word building thing. Word building dissonance thing. I am revealing my thought process behind this markering while I don't want you to do anything about it right now.
Alright, I've cool. got this. This is the magic behind the curtain.
Yes. Okay, I will sip my coffee now.
I haven't really got anything. I just think with this first paragraph, we just need to add a few more descriptors and things like that. That's all I've really got. I could sit here and babble about Split Personality 1 if the people want, but I think I've already done that enough in another few episodes. The babble counter is full.
Also, what we can do, what I can do with one hand, is to make like a mini outline or scene outline within the scene point. So, or you can take notes. I will babble.
Okay, I can take notes while you babble.
About there, yes. So, point one. Vehicle arrives, and we readers are granted a description. Like we get a broad strokes picture of the district that they're in. Glimpse of the characters. But at this point, we're not write this down. At this point, we're probably not gonna grant any details yet because we're still at the seed level.
Mm-hmm.
And after this, I might add a point about how the driverless vehicle takes off again, and the point there is that it is indeed driverless because nobody in their right mind would visit this area, especially after dark. Lights from the spaceport that are visible here, but at the same time, this district is clearly, you know, off the charts. Like not a good area. It's like it is. Shall I put it? It is unmistakably tied to the spaceport, and probably the spaceport business is inevitably tied to this district. But you can tell that there is a connection between the port and between this area. But you don't show it in reputable company, or you don't you try not to advertise that. Basically, what I'm trying to say in a very convoluted way here is that behind all successful official business, There's a healthy dose of shady business, whether you acknowledge it or not, or whether it's visible or not. Also, to make like a carpet statement, behind every booming economy, there is a healthy shadow economy. divided the material up right now is to keep the people description separate from the scenery description. But I think later on, when we have already worked through all this, later on it's gonna meld together into sort of one presentation. But right now we can keep them separate. So let's moving on. Let's hop on to the point two.
Where do you want me to put the notes for this one? Just under where it says notes?
No. Put them here.
Okay.
So basically, the way I imagine it is that all this, the old notes and the old text will be like, we won't touch this. This will be our reference material, and what you're writing now will become the new material.
Mm-hmm.
So, outline for the scene or outline for the section. Right, so we start off, like, I think a good start off would be that the two figures are now out of their vehicle. Just stand there and stare. They will move in a covert manner from shadow to shadow. And mention that their moves are highly coordinated, although neither utters a sound.
Military's only got one L. Militaristic suits.
Suits and the environmental cloaks over them. And here we also mentioned that their faces are also behind some sort of visors or masks.
Oh, does meshes have an E on it? Oh, it so does.
And they keep moving. Until they reach... And this... I think this comes with the next one. So until they reach a place that they were looking for. The cross on the map, basically. Oh, I have an idea. What if their movement is not all on the street level or on the ground level? What if, let's say, one of them climbs up to, let's say, top of some structures and provides the tactical view from up high while the other moves on the ground.
Hmm.
saw is the fact that they move as one, they keep in sync, they keep up to each other, they move where they have to, all that without saying anything out loud.
Now I blow my nose.
meanwhile, we move this point up here. So this section ends when they reach the cross on the map. Oh yeah, and as they regroup again, we might be shown a little bit of their gear.
Have I turned my microphone back on?
Yes.
Okay, cool.
So we might get a glimpse of some high-tech handles and blades, but not too much. So the gear should be very light and ergonomic and not hinder their movement, and the gear should sort of blend together with their suits. And what doesn't blend together with their suits is covered up by the cloaks. So, let's say at some point when one of the cloaks gets pushed aside or swished up as someone jumps from the roof. Aha! Okay, now I'm getting something. So, who am I kidding? It's Rogue who's climbing. So, when Rogue jumps down from the higher vantage point, the cloak brushes aside for a little bit so that we get a glimpse of some of the gear.
That's the level of my intelligence today.
Higher vantage cloak.
Yeah.
The level of detail that we need right now. So once they are both on the ground and regrouping, they might still move a little bit longer, like a few more steps to go or a street to cross. And again, they don't speak. And again, they move very synchronized. Do you get it?
One note I will make real quick is that while the rest of their equipment, like the cloaks and everything that conceals them, is high tech, their swords aren't really, like, I'd say they're a step up from training weapons, probably.
That's what I'm saying. You only get to see like handles and like you can see that they are equipped, but you don't get to see an inventory list of either one's arsenal.
All right.
And now this is a more thorough topic for another day, but I think we might need to sync up what I mean when I say high tech. Like, I don't mean blinking lights or any of that. I mean like smart materials and sitting well and that sort of thing.
Right, got ya.
So it's like when you say, oh, she has a sword, I'm like, yeah, okay, fine, she has a sword, but that sword has been smartly made.
Right, I'm
so
with you.
Yeah, so that will become relevant later. But right now, let's just stick with the... We can see some handles and like, ergonomic shit, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, onward to the building. This is where one of them speaks up and says, "This is it."
I seem to have adopted a rather colourful highlight. Let me get rid of this.
I don't know where that came from. Why would you want to break it down or any of that? So this would allow us to emphasize the contrast between the city on the other side of the port and this district. So it's like in the city, the nano engineering would have broken down the materials and grown them into fluctuating gazebo. it's a placeholder, but put it in into a flaming gazebo. However, flaming gazebo shall be a bad name. However, this area here looked like it belonged to a different place. Looked like it belonged to a scrapyard on some... We can drop the word discount moon here, I guess. Belonged to a scrapyard on some discount moon. Rather than a bustling hive of commerce and intrigue.
Really hamming this up, right?
That's what second drafts are for. So it's like, first draft is for getting the shit down. Second draft is to get your ham down.
Oh, bless me.
Okay. Now, once we have hammed up the description, that's when we should reveal, and I think we have it already in the notes. Oh, no, we don't. That's when we should reveal some of extra human or human plus powers. So whatever way they are entering, maybe they are using a side hatch or a... I think we can use the logic that they will also locate what used to be the emergency hatch of a... Once the structure was an actual ship, it used to be an it used to have an emergency hatch that can be opened manually and from outside. Because that's a thing. That's a security feature. So they will locate where that hatch is now that the structure is no longer a ship. So it might be accessible from plain ground level, or it might require some further climbing. And I'm thinking there should be a reason for either of them to speak up. So it's like if everything is going smoothly, if they are, you know, doing everything as planned, then their connection is so strong that they shouldn't need to verbalize anything. However, if there's a disagreement, then they would need to, you know, clear things up verbally. So for example, let's say they have a disagreement about how to approach this, how to enter. Let's say Rogue wants to break down the main, the street side door, street side hatch, and barge in, while Luna would want to locate the once been emergency hatch and get in a more covert way. And then it's like, where are you going? Come on, I'm finding a side hatch. What do you want a side hatch for? The is right here. We don't need to make any extra noise, or we don't need to cause any extra damage, or we don't need to cause any extra killings if we can avoid it. So some of this discussion could already start here. And I'm thinking in the end, this dispute should end with Rogue groaning like, fine, you could have told me that before. Now we have to climb again. Something like, you could have told me all that before I was, before I jumped down, or when I was still up on there. Now we need to climb again. And we can again present it by argument, so Rogue is victorious, like, see, it's not gonna be as easy, let's go back to the main door. for placeholding's sake, I will call it front door. Let's go back to the front door, this is too much hassle. And Luna's like, oh, shut up, I've got this. And then she peels off her gloves and places her palms on the hull, and swoosh, and some circuits get fried and so on. Sparks fly.
Whee!
And once they descend, so like this section ends once they have gotten the hatch open and they descend into the ship. Some of the argument about Luna not wanting to cause any extra deaths, and Dre looks like, let's just pick the fastest way, we can kill anybody who gets on our way, and Luna's like, no! So I would think that the obstacles, once they are inside the ship, shall be 0.1 physical. Like they will have to figure out their movement inside the ship. Again, think Jewel invading Gorgea.
Yeah.
So maybe they need a map or something, or a deep scan, mental scan. Then another obstacle is the possibility of henchmen. And the third obstacle is their disagreement about what to do with said henchmen.
Third obstacle is basically each other.
yeah, exactly. And I think this is something that we could play up even more. So, for the location and navigation, I'm guessing that they can sort of, well, let's say one of them, oh, Luna could be like, if I focus hard enough, I can create a mental image, and Rogue's like, or we could just use the map and snatches some info off the wall or something. Some sort of low-tech crude solution there instead of reclaimer powers. And there might also be the point there that maybe she shouldn't rely on, or maybe she should be saving her mental energy for when it's really needed. Like instead of squandering all her quote unquote psi for getting the stealthiest outcome, she should just pick and choose when to use the powers and when not, and when to just, I don't know, use the map.
Yeah.
Or we could use the map. There might be a point there that she shouldn't just use the powers willy-nilly because they haven't rested well or something like that. So basically insert a possible conflict regarding the power use. To navigation, sure they can detect the rooms using the map, but the part where Luna has to, you know, sense the human activity around them, that is still valid.
back at the lab.
Yeah, meanwhile, back at the lab. Don't write this down, but I'm thinking that the format of the map might vary. So, like, maybe there is literally an evacuation plan stapled on the wall, or maybe, well, painted on the wall in that case, or maybe Rogue downloads it from somewhere, which means their suits would have to accommodate some gadgetry as well.
Mm-hmm.
Like, when it comes to this point, I think I don't have the full scope of ideas that we could use here yet. But I think this three-point guideline that what kind of obstacles they will face, this is what will give us the material here. So physical obstacles, henchmen, and each other.
Yep. It works. I have nothing to add.
Okay. Right. I think maybe let's pause here. I feel my brain is starting to shoot blanks now. So this is the hammy draft. The shitty draft, the hammy draft, and the clean draft.
Mm-hmm.
So our work on the hammy draft will continue in the next episode. Until then, check out our short stories. I mean, our reading samples. I will type. I will show it on screen. ChaosNova.co.uk is where we have plenty of hammy drafts. And these hammy drafts are the distillate. they are the result of working through some of our forum-based roleplay posts. So, check out Seeker. I will kind of scroll and show it. Check out Seeker. Right now it is only a written book. We're working on it. We're working on trying to get it into audio as well, but we will need to do some homework until that happens. But yes, for now you can get it in text form of Amazon and other places as shown here. That's it.
Thanks for watching.
Yes, say something. Something. Okay, yes, thank you everybody for watching, and we shall continue the next one. Bye.
Mm-hmm. Bye.